Welcome to the Maison Française. I'm Shani Peer. I'm the director here. And I want to thank all of you for coming and for patiently waiting. I'm so glad that we turned out to have just enough seats for everyone who came. We are really absolutely delighted tonight to welcome Jacques Pepin back to Colombia to talk with us this evening about his life and times as a French chef on two continents. And this event is presented by the Maison Française and the School of General Studies. So I'd like to thank them for being our partners. I've been wanting to invite Jacques to speak at the Maison Française for several years now, and now seemed like the perfect opportunity as his visit is timed to coincide with the launch of our beautifully renovated kitchen upstairs on the second floor, with large picture windows overlooking the campus. Thanks to generous sponsorship support from Bofi and Mila, which donated all the appliances, and Flos for light fixtures, and one of our trustees, John Gallette. So our new kitchen will allow us to develop new programming activities focused on French and international food and cooking and culinary culture and history for events that could range from demonstrations and tastings to cooking classes and food performances. So if you have any ideas, please let us know and stay tuned as our plans for the new kitchen unfold. So I said we're welcoming Jacques back to Colombia because he was actually a student here. He graduated from the School of General Studies. And he did an MA in French literature in the French department across the street. And he actually embarked on a PhD before making the decision, instead of becoming a university professor, to go back to his first love of cooking. So I'm hoping we'll hear a little bit more tonight about his student days at Columbia and how he made that choice. Jacques has written about all this and more in a warm and poignant memoir called The Apprentice, which we have for sale out in the lobby, and I think he'd be happy to sign copies if you'd like to buy a copy after the talk. He has been, of course, widely influential in bringing French cooking to America and bringing French cooking techniques and recipes into American homes through a number of TV shows, cooking TV shows, including The Complete Pépin, Chez Pépin, and Julia and Jack Cooking at Home with Julia Child. And through many best-selling cookbooks, most recently Essential Pépin, that includes a DVD demonstrating, quote, every technique a cook will ever need. So we have copies of those for sale in the lobby as well.
Yeah. Oop. A DVD.
And so in addition to his number of TV shows, he's also published many best-selling cookbooks, and this is just the last example, which I think has 700 of his favorite recipes. Jacques is also the Dean of Special Studies at the International Culinary Center in New York, and he teaches gastronomy at Boston University. He's won a number of honors, including several awards from the James Beard Foundation, such as a Lifetime Achievement Award and a French Legion of Honor. And Jacques will be joined in conversation tonight by the one and only Adam Gopnik, who is, of course, an author and staff writer with The New Yorker. Adam lived and wrote in Paris for about 5 years for The New Yorker, and published a wonderful collection of essays at the end of that stay called Paris to the Moon. He's published a number of other books, including Angels and Ages, a short book about Darwin, Lincoln, and modern life, and Through the Children's Gate and Winter. He is also currently working on a ballet about The Little Prince and other projects. And I should add that Adam was recently named a Chevalier in the French Order of Arts and Letters. We thought he would be the We thought Adam would be the perfect interlocutor with Jacques tonight, not only because he's such a keen observer of France and French culture, but also because he has a particular fondness for food and cooking and writing about food. His most recent book is The Table Comes First, Family, France, and the Meaning of Food. It's a wonderful book. I recommend it. And like Jacques, Adam first learned to love cooking, and French cooking in particular, from his mother. So they have that in common. So we're going to show a short video that was a tribute video made about Jacques' life for the New York Food and Wine Festival a couple of years ago, and then we'll launch into a conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Charlie, you made that video?
I was born just before the Second World War. It's a while ago.
In Geneva, and ever since I can remember, I was always fascinated by the kitchen. I must have inherited the desire to cook from my mother. After the war, she ran several small family restaurants with names like Le Pelican, Chez Pépin, and the Hotel L'Amour. By the time I finished primary school at 13, I knew what I wanted to do. I was determined to become a chef. I can still remember perfectly the first day of an apprentice at the Grand Hotel de l'Europe in Bourg-en-Bresse. That was 50 years ago, and I've been in the kitchen ever since. Welcome to Everyday Cooking. In this series, I'd like to emphasize aspects of cooking that will help you feed yourself and your family. As a professional chef, I may go a bit faster than you do with a knife. Don't be too impressed by it. As long as it's good at the end, that's what's important. The year was 1959. I decided to gamble and come to America. My luck paid off right away when I got a job working for Chef Pierre Frenet at Pavillon, New York's most famous restaurant. But then came along Howard Johnson. He offered Pierre the job as a VP, and I went along to become the director of research and development.
And this is the way they did it at Howard Johnson?
The way I remember it. Yes.
No!
I think he bring cooking to another level, particularly when he was cooking with Julia Child. Both of them, they are so funny.
A turkey that is made just the way you are. It has the shoulders and the knees and the hips. If you think of that, you won't get so mixed up.
I think you look better than a turkey.
We have something better.
Oh, that. Where did you steal it?
He's one of the best teacher in the world. When he came here, everybody loved to say hello to him. Everybody loved to talk to him. He give advice to the student. He loved to make flour with butter. So for him, butter is a garden. That man is full of talent. He knows how to write. Like a Connecticut Yankee, you know. He paints fantastically. When we have a menu, he makes beautiful things. And he knows how to cook. Everything he's doing is true, simple, clear, and true. He's a Renaissance man.
Happy cooking.
My granddaughter.
Wonderful to be here with you. It's terrific to have you all here. We will try, and this is a little bit like a cinemascope evening. We will try and keep connected to everybody on all sides of the room. Let me point out, first of all, just to italicize the unbridgeable gulf between two civilizations, that Jacques is toasting our evening, our conversation with a glass, good glass of white wine, and I am on Starbucks espresso, actually made upstairs, and really good coffee it is. And I need to be, as an American, I need to increase my anxieties before we speak. Oh. And Jacques needs to
relax.
You to relax before talking. Yeah. Jacques, I didn't know until I read your book that you and I have one thing in common, and that is that we are both ABD. We have all a dissertation.
Right.
Because you actually studied here and thought of doing going all the way.
Yes, I mean, you know, I came here the 11th of September, 1959, and on the 22nd or 23rd, I was enrolled at Columbia. Never heard of Columbia, of course. I came on a student boat, you know, okay, coming back from Europe, like 1,200 students, and there was a professor on board. I didn't speak English quite well. I had, not at all, in fact. I studied, but I said, you know, I think I want to go back to school a little bit. He said, the best school is Columbia, so I came here. And then I entered an English foreign student. I barely made it, then went to another class for a couple of years, and I did English for freshmen. So I went and I say, what do I do to continue? Since I left school when I was 13, never went to high school. So they say, well, there's a validation program. You have to take an entrance examination, and if you pass it, we put you on a validation program, to which I did. For another 2-3 years, eventually I was in general study, and I did my BA and eventually MA. And then it was at the time where any good mother would have wanted her child to marry a doctor, a lawyer, an architect, but not a cook. Now we are genius, it's different. So everything was changed. So at that time, when I proposed a doctoral dissertation, history of French food, that is, within the context of civilization and literature, starting at the Pleiad poet, Ronsard, and so in the 16th century, up to Proust, early 20th century, told me, are you crazy? so I didn't finish it.
So what year was that, Sean?
I think it was 1970.
So you're ABD 43 right
yeah,
now.
Right? Right, something like
that. I'm only ABD 34, so we're working on it. But I was hoping you would mention that, Jacques, because one of the amazing things, and this is an extraordinary book, which I urge everyone to read, a really beautiful, beautifully written book. And one of the fascinating things about it for me, Jacques, was that it's very much about a life, in a sense, before the flood. That is, it's about your formation as a chef at a time when to be a chef, even a great chef, was still something that was more artisanal, was still more a craft than it was the art that we recognize today.
It's still artisanal for me. there are a few chefs which may transcend this a little bit, but to a certain extent, it's the technique, it's the knowledge. In the kitchen, the more you repeat, ad nauseam, so that it becomes so much part of yourself that now you can afford to forget it. So I can go on television, talk to you, and slice an onion because it's part of my genetic makeup now. I've repeated so much. That being said, you can be a very good technician. I know a few chefs, which are relatively good technician and relatively lousy cook too. So if you only are a technician, it doesn't go farther. But likewise in a painting, I paint for years also. You can spend 2-3 years in a studio learning the law of perspective, learning how to mix yellow and blue to make green. With your thumb you do that, with a spatula too. And you can stand outside and make one painting after another. Does that make you an artist? Not really, but if you happen to have talent, now you have the knowledge in your hand to take that talent somewhere. Likewise with the cook, if you're a good technician, if you happen to have talent, then you can really take it somewhere, and if you put a little bit of love into it, then you can get to some really good food, someone like Thomas Keller or Daniel and so forth,
Jacques, I'd love to talk though some about your formation, because it's a fascinating story. Your mother, as you say, was a restaurateur in the great French gastronomic capital of Lyon.
My mother is going to be 99 next month.
Oh my God, I didn't realize she was still alive.
Oh my God.
And so she ran a series of little restaurants, some a little more ambitious than others, in Lyon in the years just after the Second World War.
Yes, it's a fallacy probably for many Americans to think in the context of French food only as male. Dominated, which to a certain extent in the Michelin, and the Michelin guide is a guide which has about 600 restaurants, 25, 23, whatever, 3-star, 2-star, 1-star. But there is 143,000 restaurants in France. So many people in my family have never even been in a Michelin 3-star restaurant, So in my family, there were 7 restaurants. And the 7 of them have been owned and run by women. They were by men, my 2 aunt, cousin, and so forth, my mother. So I was the 4th male, actually, to go into that business.
That's a fascinating thing, because it's a side of French, the kind of the organic life of French cuisine that we forget. But your mother's kind of restaurant, as you described beautifully, was a sort of 5-franc restaurant, right?
Oh, yes,
where
yes.
You could come in and get 3 courses for less than a dollar.
Yeah, it was 5 francs when I came here to 1958. It was 5 francs and the dollar was at 5. So it was $1. So you had a choice. You had like 4 or 5 hors d'oeuvres, like an artichokes or a salad of tomato, something very simple like that. So you pick that up. Then you had a fish or a meat. More meat, like a stew too, and sometimes herring or whiting, a simple fish sauté. And then the vegetable always separate, a bowl of carrot or whatever it may be, and then a dessert. And then you had that menu. For that, you choose whatever you wanted. The service was included. bread was included, and a quart of wine. All was that for $1, you know, so. And there was a competition in the street, so I mean, at that time, the biggest part of it was probably going to the market. And it may sound romantic now, but I don't think it was for us, my two brother and I, at 7 o'clock in the morning before going to school, we didn't have car at the time, go to the market near the Saône River in Lyon. We were between Saône and Rhône, two rivers in Lyon. And that the big market, which started at 3 o'clock in the morning, which is about a mile and a half long. My mother would walk the market and buy on her way back that case of mushroom because it was getting dark and he knew the guy couldn't keep it, or that case of this every day, and we carry it home and she started doing her vegetable for the day and all that. So, you know, it was always simple and organic, not for being, you know, mighty, you know, in terms of being organic and all that, but that didn't exist otherwise, and then there was no refrigeration. We had an ice box, you know, a box with a block of ice, which came, so, you know, she had some fish and meat there, but that was it for the day. So everything else would be done every day, that the way
so it was seasonal and local, but nobody talked about it, isn't it?
Right. No, it was local. Seasonal, you're right, yes.
That way. And you say, too, and it's a funny thing, I think people who... when you walk into a kitchen, you either never want to leave or you never want to go back to the kitchen. And one, and your
brother—that's true, you know.
Your brother was of the second kind. Yes?
Right. Yes. My older brother, you know, he became an engineer. My younger brother went into the business also, but he was really very casual. He just wanted to stay in the country, have a little bistro, play pool, and those type of cuisine my mother did. You know, I went to Paris. I started working. You know. Trying to move forward.
But your formation was really made in the classic old French model, which guess is more and more is vanishing from the world. You did your sort of your basic work at the Grand Hotel de l'Europe.
Yes, in Bourg, yes, right.
And that was, as you said, that was truly a boot camp.
Young
chef. But you were sent to find the boning machine. You
That's
were
right. Well, it was a rite of passage, you know, so I was 13 years old and, you know, you go in, there is a strainer, there is a grinder, you know, machine at the time starting, I'd never seen anything like this. And so the chef, part of the tradition, the oldest apprentice, the youngest apprentice was me, say you have to go get la machine à désosser les poulets, you know, the machine to bone out the chicken. So of course they think at that hotel or whatever, so, you know, I rush there with to whatever hotel it was, and the chef, of course, they all call one another. He said, the machine, I just gave it to l'escargot, another restaurant. So, you know, I rushed to l'escargot, he sent me to another one. Finally, I got to the last restaurant, and he told me, well, you're lucky, you better get back, your chef already called, he's really mad, I mean, you've been gone 3 hours. See, I'm carrying the stuff here, a big bag with stuff, and I turned La Rue Bichat, the little street near the Hotel de l'Europe, and I saw everyone in front of the door, the chef, the apprentice, two waiting for me. So he cracked my eye open, and I had three cement blocks, of course, in it, which I carried too, but I sent the next apprentice to get the weight for the souffle.
I love that story. In the journalism world in New York, it always was, on your first day, you had to go wash the carbon paper. That was the job they sent you on, actually, to do. If anybody remembers what carbon paper was, it was like it was the journalism's version of the boning machine.
Some mess.
Yeah, in the... But one of the things, too, is with your formation was technically impeccable, mm-hmm. but you weren't encouraged to express yourself as a cook.
Yes, I mean, I worked in Paris, you know, the place I could think at the time, you know, and I was talking to the young man who came here from the French Culinary Institute to help me because we're cooking after, right? Yes. And to do the thing, I said, you're not married, you know, you don't have a wife, you don't have kids, so try to work with really good people, and even if you don't get as much money, you know, it pays off later on. Some people can afford it, some can't, you know, and that's basically what I did when I left home. I started at 13 very early, so I finished my apprenticeship, I wasn't even 16. I worked in Aix-les-Bains a season, and eventually I went to Paris. Told my mother, I'd never been to Paris, of course, that I have a friend, I had a job, which I did. I came to the Gare de Lyon with my two suitcases, you know, and I knew one guy at Cole, there was no telephone at the time, so I walked down, I don't know how many miles to get to his house that I find and knock at the door, and he was there, I think with a young lady. He took me in, and the day after I went to La Société des Cuisiniers de Paris, Society of the Chef of Paris, and start getting a job, from one job to another and so forth. And I worked in Paris almost eight, nine years.
You talk in the book very beautifully about how you learn so much by visual osmosis, beautiful phrase.
And right.
If I may, I just thought this was such a beautiful paragraph, Jacques, if you'll allow me to read it. So by touching a piece of meat, and it describes a kind of training that is still the ideal training and maybe is vanishing a bit. By touching a piece of meat, I learned to determine its degree of doneness. Raw meat was spongy, well-done meat hard. Hearing was significant too. The snap of an asparagus spear, the crunch of an apple, the pop of a grape are all indicators of freshness and quality. I learned to listen to the sizzling sound of a chicken roasting in the oven. When le poulet chante, the chicken sings, I knew that the layers of fat had clarified and the chicken was done. Smell was of importance in recognizing quality. A fresh fish smells of the sea, seaweed and salt. Fresh meat has a sweet smell. Fresh poultry, practically no smell at all. Melons, pears, tomatoes, raspberries, oranges, and the like, each have their own distinctive fragrance when perfectly ripe. So you were getting a sensory education as much as a technical education.
Yeah. Goes back to proofs, you know, the affective memory in proofs, you know, remembering a thing past. You know, you talk about the little, the tea, you know, the cup of tea that bring back his own memory of Combray, the little village where he used to go as a child, the little town. And with it, then by association of idea, you know, he saw the cook, and then he saw the garden, and he saw the priest walking down, and he saw the whole village of Combray came out of that cup of tea. And he said, but that's very important for a chef, because the memory of food like this are different than the memory of the intellect. If you ask me, how do you say, where were you in 1959? I say, well, I have to think of it. Yeah, I was in Paris, I work at that point, whatever. But when I walk in the wood with my dog, and I smell mushroom all of a sudden, that I'm brought back when I was picking mushroom with my father or whatever, I'm 7, 8 years old, and those memories are very immediate, very powerful, much different than the memory of the intellect, you know, those affective memory, whether it's the smell, the taste, the view, the touch, or whatever. And that was a big part of Proust, which I adore, of course.
Yes, so actually, last time I was sitting here, I was talking about Proust with Antoine Compagnon, you put it much more lucidly than either of us did, much more concretely. Does your life still, despite it being professional for you, do you still have those kinds of effective memories when you're working?
Oh, sure, yeah. I'm always hungry, so that's part of it. Yeah, no, and my daughter now, you saw my daughter and granddaughter there at the end. Now she does some show with me. And yes, for us, the smell, the touch, I mean, I've been married 48 years or so, and my wife was born in New York City. I don't remember of any time that we didn't have dinner sitting down at night and sharing a bottle of wine. I mean, that's really part of who we are, part of the day, part of our life, and for us that's very important. It's a lifestyle that's how we live, you know. Yeah. Some people do not, but it's fine. But for us, all of those, and playing pool, and drinking wine, and going fishing, and picking up mushroom, and all of those things, or at the beach, I pick up a different type of beach plum, you know, that I do, or other type of thing, or the wildflowers, rose that I do with the petal, I crystallize the petal with sugar or things like that. You know, that's all part of the summer tradition, from starting with the pissenlit, you know, the dandelion, hopefully in a couple of weeks, that will come out in my garden, and we'll have to have a couple of those that clean your blood in the spring. You need that. You know, so.
Your father was a wine lover. He was
He had
around Saint-Amour, the beautifully named.
Oh yes, Saint-Amour. Yes, right. One of the Beaujolais. Yes.
Yes.
But my father was the antipode of a white snob. I mean, he knew that Bordeaux existed, and they did pretty decent wine. That was about it. You know, he drank Beaujolais, Côte du Rhône. That's where we live. That's what you drink. That's
between
what
the two rivers. Right?
Yeah, but you know, there is. the Beaujolais Ordinaire, then the Beaujolais Supérieur, then the Beaujolais Village, which is Ferdinand Village, and there is the Grand Cru du Beaujolais, which is 12, Saint-Amour, Brouilly, Côte de Brouilly, and so forth, which are basically the same. You know, it's done with the same grape and so forth, but my father would be able to recognize between those Beaujolais, so that's
that, that is a palate.
Yeah, but that's only drink, but he liked
because for an uneducated Beaujolais drinker, Beaujolais tastes like Beaujolais.
Exactly.
For the most part. I couldn't help, you were talking about your years in Paris cooking, and today being a sort of auspicious day in French political history, there is a new prime minister at Matignon, and you actually cooked for quite a while at Matignon, and for de Gaulle. Yeah.
Yes, someone introduced me the other day, said that man was chef to three French presidents, and the three of them are dead. All right, so, under the Fourth Republic, from the end of 1956 to the end of 58, on 59 when I came here, I worked there under three governments. Under the Fourth Republic, the government were changing at a rapid pace, and de Gaulle came
faster
to power
the plates.
On the 12th of May, 58. Yes, that was another world. But again, you work there, it was your job. I mean, I dealt with Madame de Gaulle to do the menu for the week, unless it was state dinner. You know, I served like Eisenhower, Nehru, Tito, Macmillan. Those were the head of state at the time. But never, never would you go or see in the dining room, you hide in the kitchen. No one ever called you, there was no kudo or anything like this. And if no one came to the kitchen, then things were successful. If someone came to the kitchen, everything went wrong. You know, so it was that type of things. Yeah, so the cook was really, really at the bottom of the social scale, you know, at the time. And that's what happened to me when I came to this country. I was offered a job at the White House for Kennedy. Well, I had done that. I'd never been on a newspaper or magazine. Those things did not exist, so I went to Howard Johnson.
Were you motivated at all by the sense that you could have a more ambitious life as a chef in America? Or were you not thinking about that side of life as much? What brought you?
Not really. I mean, I came to America because I was free. Everyone wanted to go to America, certainly at the time. It's the Golden Fleece. It was the El Dorado. I mean, you want to go to America. I came here and I stay a couple of years, you know, in New York. And first day I came to New York, I loved it and never went back. I mean, I have to say that most people who emigrate to America emigrate because of economic reason, get a better life, or maybe racist reason, maybe religious reason, maybe political reason. And many, many of those, I didn't have any of those reasons. I came here, I had a good life, I did very well in France, but I loved it and I never went back. And it was another world too. At the time when I was at Columbia in 1959, 60, 61, I used to cross Morningside Drive and go to a bar in Harlem and have a drink with friends and listen to jazz. Before the assassination of Kennedy and Martin Luther King, it was very, very different. You could go there, walk to then after it became different.
You came here and you went to work, as you saw in the film, at a legendary French restaurant,
right.
Le Pavillon, named, as you remind us, after the pavilion of the 1939 right. New York World's Fair. Have you ever seen, by the way, the menu from 1939 World's Fair?
Yes,
it's one of the most beautiful, beautiful things.
Yeah.
It shows shows the Eiffel Tower on top of the world.
And you should see the wine list. I mean, amazing.
Exactly. But you say something very interesting, two things that fascinated me about Henri Soulet, and this was one of the temples of sort of snob cuisine at the period, but that some of the cooking you point out was actually quite simple by today's standards. You talk about that wonderful roast chicken you used to do. Unpretentious in
many ways. I mean, certainly things were still served on platters, you know, side one. People don't think that Nouvelle Cuisine was that important, but it was important in many ways. Certainly, at that time, certainly in Paris, I've never served anything on a plate. Mm-hmm. Well, at the Pavillon, never. Even my mother in the small restaurant at $1, you know, she would serve a whiting too, but it was on a platter. You bring it to the table. You never even thought of serving on a plate. Even at home, my mother would do a roast, put it in the center. We help ourselves. You would never bring a plate. And now, you are practically no chef with not serving on plate.
Yes.
You know, that's a thing of Nouvelle Cuisine, certainly. So a lot of things changed. But at that time, it was still a very classic menu in the style of Escoffier, practically, as I did in Paris. I think it was fine, it was good. I didn't think it was extraordinary. I had done, I think, better job in Paris. Just, you know,
you mentioned, too, that the vegetable cuisine was extremely modest and limited.
Right.
You were sort of surprised by that, that Americans didn't seem to have a...
Yes, we didn't really much, no. In Paris, when I worked at the Plaza Athénée, we were 49 chefs, we were 520 employees. Le entremetier, what is called l'entremetier, which goes back to the 16th century, the word entremet, which at that point was dessert as well as vegetable. Entremetier was the vegetable man. So we were four, the chef entremetier, you know, the chef de partie, so-called head of that department, and three commis underneath, because, I mean, basket of string beans and peeling asparagus and stuff, there was a lot of work at the entremetier. Compared to that, at the pavillon, it was very modest in terms of vegetable.
Yeah, no, it was
And then it turned totally. And another thing, too, there was much more grilling in France. At the Plaza Athénée, we had two big grills for fish to. Mm-hmm. There was no grill. Even at the pavillon, there was no grill. There was broiler.
Mm-hmm. Which is
so interesting. And then now, grilling is such an American thing, and vegetable and all that.
We do nothing but grill and eat green things, right? And so I was fascinated by that, too. And Soule seems to have been a difficult man to work with. He actually threw the Kennedys out of the restaurant once, or didn't throw them out, but he called them out.
I think he was probably a Republican. But at the place of the pavillon, there was a place called La Royale, you know, the best table where most important people, the Duke and Duchess of Windsor, they already eat there. And the pavillon, the Kennedy clan already ate at the pavillon for years, and usually led by Joseph Kennedy, you know, the dean of, and then at the time, at the beginning of 1961, during the campaign when they were starting, then they came to eat there, and, you know, Jack Kennedy as well as his father and everybody, and then a photographer came in and started shooting pictures. So Soule called, it was Fred Doug, it was Martin de Cray was the director of restaurant, and he said, Martin, tell that guy to get out of here. So, it was Mr. Kennedy, Joseph Kennedy, rather called Martin de Cray and said, get that photographer out of it. And then Soule was next door, probably in a bad mood and so forth, said, who do you think they are? They think they're already at the White House. The only one who decides to stay or go at the pavilion is me. So they got up, they paid, and never came back to the pavilion. And probably the reason also was that, it was Fred de Grey, because Martin de Grey, the former maitre d', had just left to open the caravel, and that was with all the people of the pavilion too. So probably Soule was in a bad mood too. They all moved to the caravel. You know.
Yes, those were the days, right, when there were all of those great New York-style French restaurants lined up
That's
in the 50s,
right.
Caravel, Côte Basque.
Yes, even Le Colony before, and Café Chauvron and so forth. Yeah.
Do you miss that world at all? Because those kinds of classic French restaurants have largely disappeared.
Well, I tell you, if I go and have dinner at La Grenouille, which I did when last year or whenever, and I really enjoyed it.
Yes.
I mean, I was in London not too long ago, and again at the Ritz, at the Savoy. I mean. And cutting a duck, you know, a well-cooked duck, which now you can only have a rare breast and a braised leg, you know, you don't have, and at that time you had a duck just like you have a roast chicken. And they cut it with fork and fork and spoon, separate from the bone and all that too. It was nice to see that again.
It's nice to see. Yes, I had one meal at the Colony not too long ago, and it was one was reminded of the joy of
The ceremony and so forth.
Of that cooking, but then you took as decisive a left turn as any chef could take. You went to work for Howard Johnson's.
Right.
And for the younger part of this audience won't have a clear sense of what Howard Johnson's was in the early 1960s.
Mr. Johnson was a client of the pavilion, you know, start with. Howard D. Johnson, the one who created the company, was an extraordinary man. So he told Pierre, you got to work for me one of these days.
Pierre Frenet
was the executive chef. And when we had those fights with Soule too, we all left. So Pierre went to work for Howard Johnson, wanted me to go with him, which I did, and frankly, it was my American apprenticeship. I worked there from 1960 to 1970 for 10 years.
10 years.
And I learned a great deal. I mean, I learned new words like, you know, bacteria and coliform, and specific gravity or whatever, because I had never learned, I didn't know anything about production, about marketing, about chemistry of food, about American eating habits, and so forth. So. Certainly. I mean, I went on in 1970 to open a restaurant on Fifth Avenue called La Potagerie, and which was a big place. In fact, I don't know who wrote a story about American cuisine at the time. It said, I forget his name, he said that I was the first soup Nazi. At the Pavillon, at the Potagerie. And after I opened the World Trade Center for Joe Baum, the two towers, so I opened the commissary, which could feed 20,000 people a day in terms of production. And I was a consultant at the Russian Tea Room for a number of years. I'm saying all of that to say that if I had not done Howard Johnson, I would never have been able to do that. It was another training that I had. It was a long American apprenticeship, I said.
It fascinated me, Jacques, in reading about it, that Mr. Johnson was ambitious for his restaurants. He wanted it to be really good.
Yes. And at the time, it was a service restaurant with waitress, too, with table serve. It was a really nice restaurant. I mean, from beef burgundy to a seafood thermidor whatever.
I mean,
we did stuff, and I was a great joy to give that to André Salter with that loot test. All my friends, I brought them frozen food. I didn't tell them it was frozen. We did it more too, and they couldn't believe it.
Well, I will tell you, when I was a small boy living in Philadelphia, the only place I wanted to eat on my birthday was Howard Johnson's. Now, I didn't know that I was eating with Jacques Pepin at that age.
The fried clam, you know, the stuff too was very good, yes.
And then, as you say, sadly, and it's a sad comment on a part of American cooking that we don't always remember, that idea got put out of business by true fast food and the whole thing declined and closed.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was a different type of thing. In fact, we did some prototype Hojo too with Howard Johnson doing, but when McDonald's came, it was another world, you know. And in fact, in the year 2000, Time magazine did a thing on the 100 most important people of the 20th century, and one of them was Ray Kroc, you know, from McDonald's. And they asked me to do the piece because I had met him, and I knew that world at the time. Uh-huh. But I tell you something: in 1966, I learned even when I did. I did a bit of research for that article. Kentucky Fried Chicken, McDonald's, and Burger King, the three companies together, were smaller than Howard Johnson in 1965. Howard Johnson was a big company. We had 1,200 restaurants, 800 motels, several commissaries all over the country. It was a big company.
I guess, you know, it actually makes me think, Jacques, it's a big question, isn't it? You know, when we talk about the revolution in cuisine in America, very often we're talking really about two cultures, right? The culture of people who are obsessed with food and care a great deal about food. And then there's another culture of fast food. And the things that used to bridge those two cultures, like Howard Johnson's, are disappearing, aren't they?
That's a very, very acute statement. I think there is a dichotomy now which did not exist before. You know, for many Europeans, they think that Americans eat only four things, you know, hot dog, hamburger, fried chicken, and
French fries,
pizza, whatever. So, and it's of course wrong, but it's right too. If you go into the mall crowd, where people eat day after day after day, those four or five dishes and so forth, then on the other hand, you know, there is 24,000 restaurants in New York, you know, and the diversity of food and the ethnicity of food in most of the greatest urban center of America is unmatched in Europe now. You know, so there is a dichotomy which probably did not exist at the beginning of the 20th century and so forth, where the food was really cheap here and everyone ate the same. I mean, steak, potatoes, stuff, apple pie and two, everyone could afford it. Basically, the food was really, really cheap. And now there is that type of economy, and the people who are interested in the food are interested in wine, are interested in a cellar, too. So it changed a lifestyle altogether different.
You mentioned André Sultner, and I had the great pleasure of cooking with him for one day about a year ago. And he was saying to me that the thing that shocked him when he arrived in America, a little after you, I suppose.
Yeah, he came in 61.
That was the absence of things that we now take for granted. You couldn't find shallots. couldn't find wild mushrooms. You couldn't find, you could find good butter, he said, but you couldn't find crème fraîche, obviously. Were you surprised by that too?
Yes. I live on 50th and 1st Avenue, between 1st and 2nd Avenue. There was a restaurant, the man who sponsored me at a restaurant called La Toque Blanche. And so we lived on top there. So we went on, what was that, something brother, on 1st Avenue, the market and all that. My first experience with a supermarket. Supermarket were just basically starting here. They hadn't started in France yet. So I thought it was fantastic to have one place where you could buy fish, meat, vegetables, instead of going to one store, another store, another store, which I was used to. But now it turned around. But what I was surprised more is package of things, there which was already packaged. And the little amount of vegetable, there was one salad, that iceberg, that's it. It was another salad. I remember going there and say, where are the mushrooms? They say, aisle 5. That was canned mushroom. you didn't have mushroom. You had to go to a specialty store in New York to get just regular white button mushroom. There was no shallot, no leek, no oriental vegetable, certainly. Not good olive oil, to no herb, tarragon, too. And now the supermarkets have never been as beautiful as they are today. It's just amazing in many ways.
It's true. One of the people who made that revolution is someone you write about and was a good friend, is Julia Child.
He
deserves a great
And Craig also. Craig
less, well, less remembered now, perhaps,
yes,
in having made that revolution.
Craig was very, very important, too. And Julia, of course. The world was very small, the world of food, that is. I came at the Pavilion, as I say, in September, I start working. Within maybe a month, 2 months, maybe three, Craig Claiborne, who just started at the New York Times, again, one of the first jobs as a food editor, type of job which did not exist, really. And he came to the Pavilion to do a piece on the Pavilion, Pierre Frenet, and I met him, we became friends. Well, I live on 50th, he lived on 51st, he had an apartment, and he introduced me to Helen McCauley, who lived on 53rd. Helen was the food editor of McCall, House Beautiful, some of you may remember her. And she was a very feisty woman from Nova Scotia, and she kind of became my surrogate mother. She was never married, never had children. She told me, don't put those stupid socks you put in front of me. Okay, so she spoke with James Beard every day on the telephone for like an hour. So through her, I met James Beard, a few weeks after. And then in the spring of 1960, she told me, look at that book. So I look at that book. I said, she, that's pretty good. She said, well, it's a woman who wrote that book. She's coming to New York next week. Let's cook for her. She's a very big woman with a terrible voice. that was Julia. So Julia came, and she wasn't known at the time because she had never done a book. She never did television. She started in 64 television, and she was never the food editor or writer for a magazine or newspaper. But what I meant is that I knew the trinity of cooking, Craig Claiborne, James Beard, and Julia Child, within like six months after I was here, not even. Because the food world was so small, and it was a different world altogether. In addition to that, I didn't know one American chef. All the chefs I knew in New York were Swiss, Italian, German, and French, of course, and many other. No American chef. You had to wait until Nouvelle Cuisine started, the young Americans start exploiting, and now there are such extraordinary chefs in America, American chefs. But at the time, it didn't exist. People didn't do that job.
Do you know one difference between the American kitchens I've been in, restaurant kitchens and French restaurant kitchens, and that's something I wanted to ask you about, is that in the French restaurant kitchens where I've observed or even pretended to work in the way that we do, there's still enormous discipline, and it's still taken for granted that the chef humiliates the other one.
Probably less and less. But
less and less,
it
but
was,
still.
It was, and as you said before, you didn't learn because the chef told you anything, you learned purely by osmosis, looking. I was 13 years old, the chef said, do that. If I had said why, he would have said, because I just told you. But the end of it, so he never teach you anything. And for a year, I clean up vegetables, do this, do that too. And then one day he came, he said, you start at the stove tomorrow. My name was you. Then I started at the stove, then he called me Jacques. That's it, 1 year. after, and I said, I don't know what to do. I went to the stove, I knew how to do it. You know, through that type of repeat and osmosis, so it was a way of learning, you know, which is probably not bad for someone who is 14, 15 years old, because if you start explaining, it comes here, it goes out, you know, on a, and then just say, do it, and it was probably better. But that's the way it was. I look at the French Culinary Institute now, where I am one of the dean. People come after 6 months, and often I'm there for the graduation as a judge when they do their final. I'm amazed, absolutely amazed what they can do in 6 months. I would never have been to do that after 3 years of apprenticeship, even though what they do in 6 months. I, of course, went probably three times as fast, because I had, you know, that they don't have enough of the technique, not enough repeat and so forth.
But you've made a reputation as a great teacher. Did you have to sort of learn to teach in an American way? Did you have to learn to?
Not really. Teaching for me was the same thing, whether I taught some literature class, I taught skiing for 11 years, you know, and cooking, it's all the same. It's a question of finding a way to communicate and finding a way to understand one another. And certainly in the same way, I remember I was teaching skiing upstate New York in the Catskill. That's how I met my wife. And so I was teaching the middle class or whatever of Catskill during the weekend. I did it for, you know, maybe a winter. Well, those kids were 10, 12 years old. If you start explaining the four line and how to hit you, forget it. You say, go up, stay close to me, let's go down. That's how they learn. And then the same weekend, I give a class to a young man, 30, with a lawyer or whatever. He want to know why he's turning, why he turned, why, and you explain. This is what we do in the kitchen now. I mean, people pay a fortune coming to the French Culinary Institute. So, you know, you explain, you show them why and this and that. It's a different way of learning altogether.
But finally, it's about perseverance and repetition, isn't it, learning?
Yes, certainly. I mean, you know, you have different plateaus, as I said. For me, the first plateau is still to become a craftsman, you know, to become a technician. Then eventually, I mean, you cannot escape yourself. Eventually, you will go back to who you are. That's what I was telling that young man, too. I mean, if I were to go to the 10 greatest restaurants of New York, you know, according to Michelin or the New York Times, those are great restaurants, without any question. But I will still pick up out of those 10, probably three, maybe four, that would say those are extraordinary for me. And then I pick up four or five that I say, they are really, really good. And a couple that I say, I don't really get it that much. So, I mean, what am I saying there? You know, the three or four that I love so much just exactly coincide with my sense of taste, with my sense of aesthetic. So it's a purely narcissistic reflection for me. Those are exactly there. And eventually, as you are, I was saying that young man, if you work with Jean-Georges or a great chef, don't try to change it. Don't try to do your own stuff. You have to try to look at the food from his sense, from his point of view, from his sense of aesthetic, from his sense of taste. Even if you don't agree with it, you do that for a year or two, and you will learn. Then you work with another one for another 2 years, and another one a year, and you do that with all of this. So you amass an enormous amount of knowledge. Then now you can, excuse the pun, you can regurgitate it, but then now you filter it, you know, through your sense of aesthetic, your sense of taste, so now you start doing your own thing. Because ultimately you can escape yourself, you are who you are, and eventually you cook with your guts, the type of food that you like to eat, and you are.
You know? You cook your soul. And
yes, absolutely.
I want to open up this conversation to people along this long...
See, you can talk road. A lot when you drink wine.
I still have so many more things
you're
I want to
still drinking coffee?
I'm still drinking coffee. I drink coffee from, I'm a New Yorker. I drink coffee from 6:30 in the morning when we take the kids to school till midnight when we turn in. So I'd love to take some questions and just hold a hand up and I will speak up so we can all hear you. Gentlemen over here.
How did you become involved with the television industry?
What got you started in TV?
Yeah, that's a good point. What was it? I forgot. I mean, I did show like What's My Line, to tell the truth, you know, when I was at La Potagerie, because one time they brought two big guys, you know, on that. One was a professor of singing and another one whatever, because a chef is supposed to be fat and big too. And I was 40 pounds younger, you know, at that age.
40 pounds younger, his expression.
That man had opened a new restaurant in New York, did that too, and he was the chef to the French president. He then, that's what they always pick up the other one because of that. So I stopped doing some shows that I was invited like this. And at some point, yes, when Julia told me, you know, after she did a couple of series, so that was the end of the 60s, she said, I'm not going to do it anymore. You should go to Kotlowitz, I remember his name, who was the program director at WNET in New York. And so I went to see him. He said, what do you want to do? I said, well, I don't know. I mean, maybe more something which is more technical to show people. She said, well, that's interesting too, but then it went nowhere. Then I was asked by WGBH in Boston, which again is a big, and it never went anywhere either. And one time I was teaching, that was in the early 80s, I was teaching in San Francisco. At some point, for like 12 years, I have to say, when the cookware shop started exploding, didn't exist, a small cooking school, you know, then I started going on the road to give the class, yes, because in 1974, I had 14 fracture in car accident, you know, so I broke my back, two hip, leg, anything was better than behind the stove as a chef, 14 hours a day, whatever. I started doing those cooking school, so I was booked a year ahead. They said, can you come next year? So, I mean, I did, you know, probably know the U.S. more than most people because I did that for years and years. And I was in Palo Alto, just outside San Francisco there. Yeah, near Palo Alto. With Martin Nguyen, and Martin Nguyen told me, you know, I'm going to do a show at the PBS station in San Francisco. I said, it's great, that's absolutely terrific. He said, do you want to do a show with me? I said, yeah, I'd love to. So I did a show there with him, and the executive producer told me, you know, it'd be interesting, do you want to do a series with us? I said, well, I'd love to. So that was like September. I said, well, I have to do it. I cannot do it until July next year, because from July to September I stop, but otherwise I was booked all over the country doing my cooking class there. So she said, fine, no problem, we'll have the money by January anyway. I said, okay, well, January came and went and they didn't have the money. I can't forget about it at that time because I have been asked a couple of times and it never went anywhere. So at some point, I call and I say, you know, my wife said, are we going to France this summer? See your mother? I said, well, I don't know. Say, are you doing that show? I said, I don't know. He said, well, if you do that show, don't you have to have like 100 recipes? I say, yes. So I call and I say, you know, if you don't have it by the end of March, or I say, I think I really cannot do it because even after I won't have time to do all those recipes for July. They say, fine, we'll get it. Well, came February, March, they didn't have it. Came the 1st of April, which was the limit, I say, that's it. They call me, they say, no, the 15th of April. They call me, they say, we have the money. It's like, I say, oh, gosh. I didn't even say gosh. So I had to do the recipe fast, and we did that series, first series, and then it kind of mushroomed, we did more. It was prior to something called the Food Channel Network, so it was very different.
Does it surprise you, Jacques, having worked in television yourself, the extraordinary success of things like the Food Channel, where people are making food, you can't smell, you can't taste, you can only look at it. Does that surprise you?
It's just amazing. I was, not too long ago, with someone who is a food historian, and he said, he was lecturing on that, and he said there is 407 cookery shows on television now. Yeah. I said, 407, I don't know whether it's accurate, but if it's not 407, it may be 350. Right. But you know, there are so many channel lifetime. I mean, I've been judged on the taste and on the, and I will again, there on the Top Chef, on, you know, so many different channels are doing, and before it was just PBS. I mean, it was really another world. And the Food Channel Network, in fact, asked me several times to go and ask Julia too, but I was like PBS, and I'm doing a new series in the fall with a new book at KQED, the PBS station in San Francisco, and that will be my 13th series of 26 shows that I do there. And talking about that, Charlie Pinsky here, who also has done many, many series on television with many other chefs, but one with me, did My Life, we call Chez Jacques, right? We went to France to shoot. We went all over the country. And it, you remember Peter? Peter Ahn, you know, the dean of General Study, came here, and we shot here as well to be part of that that special, which was a special for PBS, a special of 2 hours. We were still kind of doing the special at the time. It was prior to the Food Channel Network. That's why they were still doing that now. You know, it's another world.
Let me take a question from over here, gentleman here, and then I'll come to this lady.
Yes. What was your question? But
All right. Let me repeat the question, if I may, so everyone can hear, including Jacques. The question is about the progress of French cooking. People were saying for many years, myself among them, that French cooking was in a state of stasis or repetition.
Rainbow, yeah.
There was a piece in the Sunday Times last week, actually, saying that there was a whole new renaissance in Paris led by non-French chefs, by chefs coming from abroad who had different backgrounds, Asian chefs and North African chefs and
right.
so on. Does that strike you as a good analysis? Do you think that French cooking was stuck and do you think it's accelerated?
I think so. I haven't been to Paris in a long time, you know. But I think that's exciting and that's great, absolutely. In the country, I mean, I go in the country and for me, I used to be, when I was giving class in the 70s, I used to tell people, you know, if you go to France, go to a three-star restaurant because the type of service, the type of quality you will have in a thing, we don't really have in this country much. Now, if I do a thing, I say, go anywhere but a three-star restaurant. You have so many of extraordinary restaurants in this country. As good, there is more three-star restaurants in New York than there is in Paris now. Mm-hmm. So go to the Ferme Auberge or the small, I mean, there is a thing called the Ferme Auberge, there is a book in the country, some are very good, some are less good, but usually it's pretty good. Whoever does the food there, it's a farm in, and more than 51%, or at least 51% of whatever is served at the table has to be produced at the farm. Some of them, it's like 85% when you really go in the country too. So it's always great, usually pretty inexpensive too. And that's really, for me, is the true color and the true soul of French cooking. From my mother, grandmother, and to more than, and maybe as I get older and older, you know, I tend to take away from the plate rather than adding, which you do as a young chef, you know, with more of this, more of that, and another herb, and more of this and that. You know, you have those dishes, which I go and people say, you like it? I say, yeah, it was very good. What is it? I don't know. It's good. You know, so as you get older, you take away, you become much more focused on the tomato, the right temperature, ripeness, with a bit of coarse salt, good river on top, that's it. You don't want anything else on it, you know, and it's a normal process, I suppose. So, yes, I've heard that, and I think it's good. On the other hand, someone talked to me yesterday or so about an article where they say that many, many restaurants in France, they don't cook anymore. It comes from factory, and the food is done there, they just reheat it or transform it a little bit.
It's worrying. There was a question here. Yes, this young lady.
Hi, I'm also a graduate.
Stand up and...
Yeah.
In Shell.
I'm also a graduate of the School of General Studies, so I just want to say merci beaucoup for coming back and supporting the school.
Oh, thank you.
A lot of what a lot of people do before GS, like you said about cooking, is very visceral or osmosis. And I was just wondering how you found the transition when you came to GS into the more cerebral world of academia and what that experience was.
It was very exciting, I mean, for me, because everyone, well, at the time I wasn't, I was older than a college student, but I was 24 or whatever, 20, you know, because when I came to this country, I was 23, yes, so I was 25, 6, 7. And I had some people my age, some much older too. We finish a class, usually small class, we went out for coffee, we discuss, we argue, people from all over the world. That was very, very exciting. When I finished there, and I got my BA. I moved to the graduate school, and it was a total decrescendo, if you want, you know. Everyone was much younger, and everyone was very aware about their grade, their stuff, too. That many people in general study, for me, you know, study for the pleasure of studying or whatever, most of them are a business. Like me, even if I had continued and finished my PhD, I would still be a cook anyway. But it was less important for me. Of course, I like to have good grades or whatever, but it wasn't kind of absolutely essential. So general study in that context was the best school that I've been to, the most exciting, the most fruitful, the most rewarding, the most, more than the graduate school, certainly, yes.
Question on this side, did I see someone here? Gentleman here. Stand up, please. And
question about how you enticed your family to be engaged with food. We hear so much about picky eaters and picky
yes.
children. And your daughter, if we watch the show, is any right. indication, is anything but, same with your grandmother. Any advice?
Well, you know.
Getting children to eat.
Yeah, when my daughter, Claudine, was 5 years old, she would ask me, Mom, what's for dinner? My wife would say, food. And, she's 46, now it's still food. You know, and her granddaughter is the same way, and my granddaughter is the same way. The point is that we sit down every day at the table and we ate. That was a right which was extremely important in our family. We never discussed the menu. Oh, you don't like this, or you don't? No, I put it on the table. And you find out that the kid absolutely loves string beans. Then 6 weeks later, they absolutely hate string beans for like 3 months, and then love them or love Brussels sprout too. I mean, if you have a child who eats spinach and you go on your knees to tell the kid, you know, we're going to eat spinach, but he wants some type of reward, you know. So certainly, we never really serve a la carte, you know, that was a dinner story. You didn't want to eat it, I said, fine. I mean, you know, you finish eating, you don't want to eat that, it's okay. But you're not eating anything else at the end of the meal. So, it wasn't that complicated. We never really discussed. By the time she was probably 6 or 7 years old, I put probably like a teaspoon of wine in her water, make her taste a little bit of what the wine should be like. But she never had soda. You know, we didn't have soda at the table either. It was water or whatever. Now it's different, and not much sweet either, because we don't really eat that much sweet, you know.
You didn't make desserts? You didn't make a
No, not much fruit in summer, although an apple tart or a caramel custard. But when we had guests, usually the difference between a meal where we have guests will be a dessert, you know. Otherwise, family, no, rarely, yes.
So,
Claudine went up and down, loving that, not loving that. I mean, she loved escargot when she was a child until she was 7 years old. That was great. Kids love usually the garlic butter and all that stuff, and they don't even know what the escargot is. But, of course, by the time she's 12 years old, she's in school, she's a yuck woman, my God, but all her friends, no one eat that, and so forth. So you go through those phases without any question. And certainly, when she was a teenage, she didn't know what she would do in life, but she knew only one thing, that she would never, never do what her father or her mother is doing. So she went to BU, and she got a degree in political science and international relations, then started working for a traveling agent, whatever, in Boston, a couple of years, went back to the graduate school, spent a year in Brussels with NATO to do a paper on the defense of Europe or whatever, came back, started selling wine, and married a chef. So the
fruit is not far from the tree. I must tell you, Jacques, my own story, my own experience with children is they have naturally beautifully perverse tastes. Whatever is exotic is there. When our son was growing up in France, in Paris, we wanted at one point, when he turned about 8 or 9 years old, we thought, we'll take him to a really good restaurant. We'll take him to our favorite place, Le Grand Vifour, just for lunch so he knows what a good thing. I said, would you like to come? We'd like to do this. And they would be glad to have you. But you have to decide to do it. And he said, well, Dad, is it Chinese food or is it just ordinary Paris food? He said, it's just Paris food. He said, no, I don't think so. If it was Chinese food, he would do it. Let me take one more question.
But you know, when they get older after, you think that it comes back to them and say, remember I ate that too? And
totally.
They're like, wow. I mean, say, You hated it at the time.
Totally. Yeah. You know, coming back to affective memory, Jacques, it's exactly true. What we discover with our kids is that the things that they ate willingly or reluctantly when they were small, before the age of 9, are the things that give them comfort and reassurance and nutrition ever after. There was someone over here. I thought I saw a hand. Here.
Yeah.
No? Didn't see? Was there... Well, let me ask you then, Jacques, just two last things that wanted very much in my mind. First, is there anything, you know, this is a wonderful book, this Essential Pepin, and you've written this beautiful memoir. Is there anything you've wanted to do that you haven't yet accomplished or that you feel you've failed at in the past and you'd like to take another shot at?
Finish my dissertation. Playing the piano, probably.
Playing the piano, really?
Yeah, I love piano. You know, in the kitchen, we call the stove a piano.
Yes, indeed.
You mentioned that. So we play the piano, you know, so we play that. Yes. Otherwise, no, I have been blessed, you know, in many ways. I have had a great life in America, a great deal of recognition. I have got a great deal of fulfillment. You know, I marry a wonderful woman, born in New York, with a Puerto Rican mother and a Cuban father. So, you know,
really many New things, many new things.
New Yorker, yeah. Yeah. So we kind of eat arroz con pollo as well as whatever, you know. So,
bouffe bourguignon.
Certainly. So.
Speaking of that, Jacques, the other thing I want to ask you is, I always find it insane when people ask, you know, what would you have for your final meal? Because you would be too anxious to eat. But what would be your, if you had to make a, I know what my favorite meal is. Right. Do you have a favorite meal that you like to make for your wife?
Well, I'll say, you know, if I know that I'm going to die tomorrow, I probably have diarrhea and I can eat it. Yes, I mean, certainly, if it had to be my last meal, it's going to be a very, 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 very long meal.
But if you have a,
you know, from a hot dog to a you know, ham and egg to a caviar to all of the food that I love, you know, in any order. And I said, often people say, what is the greatest food? And I say, and it's true, if I can think of the greatest bread in the world that I know, and the greatest butter, very difficult to beat bread and butter, you know?
Yes, that's a beautiful answer, Jacques. Yeah. Jacques, it's a joy to sit here and talk to you. And it seems to me that you are long overdue an honorary doctorate from Columbia University to celebrate. He volunteered to sign copies of his two things, so he'll be outside, and so will I, and glad to take some more of your questions and
thank you. Thank you very much for coming.